Hello, welcome again to Expound the Bible. I'm your host, Nathanael Morel. In this study, I want to focus on talking about sexual harassment and its connection to the holidays and also the hashtag MeToo movement. Now, you may be saying, what does sexual harassment have to do with the holidays? You know, what does, you know, New Year's, Valentine's Day, Easter, Christmas, you know, those are the major holidays in the year. What does that have to do with sexual harassment? And really, when we see society, we know that society ain't getting better. Society right now is getting worse, especially towards the sexual perversion side. And we see a lot of men, we are looking at, a lot of men in Hollywood, a lot of men in the political world, Senate, Congress, a lot of men in the media, news world, you know, they are one by one resigning their positions because of women accusing them of sexually harassing them. And we're seeing that like a dime a dozen now. It's like every time you look at the news, you know, here's a sexual harassment case, somebody famous, you know, gets has to resign because, you know, of sexual harassment. But despite what the media is saying, and though it may be true, I'm not saying they're false, but it's the media's making it seem like if it's all the men that are doing this sexual harassment thing. And actually, when you look at the studies, yes, 80% of men are sexually harassing women, but a good almost 20% are women sexual harassing men. And really, I saw a YouTube video, a social experiment that they were doing, and they had a woman sexually harassing a guy. And everybody seemed to be okay with it. You know, they did it in a public place. And, you know, the woman was sexually harassing him, touching him in places that he obviously made it clear he did not want to be touched. And saying stop it and everything, but she would not stop. And everybody thought it was funny. Then they switched it around where the man now is sexually harassing the woman. And the woman is saying stop. And he's trying to touch her in places where ought not to be. And everybody now in public, it's in a public area, and everybody now comes to the woman defense. So we see how the media has been pushing society that, yeah, it's the men problem. It's the men problem. It's a man problem that's going on. But really, there are also women out there that are also guilty of this. And when you read the Bible has no place for sexual harassment. Now, sexual harassment is not found specifically in the Bible, but when you read the biblical guidelines for purity, sexual purity, and what must one do to maintain themselves pure, you find that sexual harassment is not part of God's plan for a person. I want to open up our Bibles to Galatians, the book of Galatians, Galatians chapter 5. I want to read Galatians chapter 5 and talking about sexual harassment. We see that society is getting worse. Now, one of the reasons why society is getting worse is because we're taking God out of society. Like the French Revolution. The French Revolution took God out of society, took the Bible out of society, and therefore all this decadency started coming. These sexual perversions started coming. Divorce rates going high. Adultery going high. Cheating going sky high. And then the reign of terror starts coming in. That was a very tough time to live in, all because they threw out God's way of life, God's law, out of society. And that's what we're doing. God is not allowed in our schools. Next thing you know, we start seeing crimes done in our schools. You know, people coming, taking guns and shooting them up. And really, guns are not the problem. It's people who are living a godless way, and they have corrupt minds, and their minds are being controlled by Satan. And that's why, because I'm telling you, if guns did not exist, they can still do things with knives and bats, which statistically kill more people than guns. But that's a different subject. But really, we are looking at, you know, crime rates done in schools, and schools were one of the first places where, you know, the word of God, prayer, you know, Christ, you know, that had to be taken away. And yet we see society saying, well, why are people doing bad things? Because you have taken away the Bible. You have taken away God out of society. So when you connect sexual harassment, why are people always sexually harassing? Well, because you are not studying the word of God to know what and how to live. And then when you connect them with the holidays, we want to look at the meaning of the holidays, the history of the holidays, and see whether sexual harassment and the holidays really could go together, or are they separate. Let's look at Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5, and then we're going to look at the holidays that God gave his people and look how his people ended up going about. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22 says, but the fruit, and we're going to read verse 22 through 24, it says, but the fruit of the Spirit, or the fruit of a person that lives a godly life, is love. Now, this love is not sexual love. This love is godly love. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy. There's no joy in a person that was the victim of sexual harassment. There's no joy in that. So, therefore, sexual harassment is not of God because it doesn't bring joy. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is a spirit of love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, and faith. Again, goodness. Sexual harassment is no good. I'm the first one saying to be against sexual harassment. Sexual harassment is not good. And here, the Bible says, God is a God of goodness. So therefore, God does not agree with sexual harassment. Going again in verse 23, meekness, temperance, against such there is no law. Verse 24, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh and the affections with the affections and lust. You look at these men and women, but mostly men, since they make up 80% of the sexual harassment cases. Men are filled with affections and lust for the women, and therefore they cannot keep themselves because they haven't given themselves totally to what the Bible and Christ says. So therefore, here they come and they start sexually harassing women. Now, the Bible tells us it's against sexual harassment, but this is one of the reasons why, because people haven't crucified the affections and lust, and everybody has a problem with that. Everybody has a problem, but the Bible says we got to try our best to get rid of that, because that's why we're seeing a lot of sexual harassment cases, because men are driven by that urge, and they see a beautiful woman, and they just, that's what they do. You know, there's just people that's what they do. And that is one of the reasons why, by taking the Bible out of society, people become corrupted. And people start killing, and people start doing things that should not ought to be, because God's way of life is being rejected. Now, when you look at the calendar that we have today, we are set up under a pagan Roman calendar. Now, we cannot get rid of the pagan Roman calendar. We are born in it. We live by it. It was a Julian calendar. It was revised under the Gregorian calendar centuries ago. And that's what we live by. We live by a pagan Roman calendar from a solar calendar by the sun, 365 days a year. God's calendar is way different. God's calendar consists of 360 days, and it's a lunar calendar based on the moon cycle. But we want to see the difference between God's calendar and man's pagan calendar, because man's pagan calendar brings in pagan traditions, pagan customs, pagan holidays. And God's calendar brings in godly traditions, godly holidays. Now, when you look at the calendar that God gave Israel, we're not going to dig deep in it, but you can find it in Leviticus 23, I believe. You could also find it in Numbers 28 and 29, I want to say. And here you see God is giving Israel a calendar, and he is listing the holidays that Israel ought to keep. God gave Israel seven holidays. We call them the feast days. Now, the feast days were crucified and nailed to the cross by Christ. That is Colossians 2:14. You know, the feast days are done away with. But you have to understand type and anti-type. And the feast days were a literal representation of what Christ was going to come down in this earth and fulfill. Now that Christ has fulfilled, the Bible says Christ was our Passover sacrificed for us. So just like the Passover, you do a sacrifice at the Passover, the literal fulfillment of that was Christ crucifying himself on the cross. Christ was the Lamb of God. And we want to compare God's calendar that he gave Israel to our calendar today. So I'm not going to go into specifics. I'm just going to name you the seven feasts and what were their purposes. The first feast or holiday that God gave Israel was the Passover. That feast was celebrated because in honor of Christ liberating the Jews, Israel, from slavery out of Egypt. Israel was in slavery for 400 plus years, and when they came out, God said, listen, you are going to celebrate this by celebrating Passover, which literally is because when the angel passed over the houses, because God said that every firstborn in the land of Egypt was going to die unless you get the blood from the lamb and sprinkle it in the doorpost of the door, between the doorpost up and bottom. And every time when the angel of God saw the house, if it didn't have the blood in the doorpost, it will go and slay the firstborn. If it did have the blood, the angel will pass over the houses and they would be saved. So that's why it's called Passover, which is again a holiday, a feast day in celebrating God redeeming Israel from slavery. So this is a holiday that led Israel's mind towards God. Not towards corruption, not towards killings, not towards sexual harassment and sexual immorality. It led them towards God. The second feast or holiday was the unleavened bread, and that was celebrated at the same time during the Passover. The third feast or holiday was the first fruits. Now, that was celebrated because, again, as we mentioned before, Israel was a highly agricultural society, you know, growing wheat, growing barley, growing corn, growing grains, fruits, and that Israel lived by agriculture and livestock. That was what they used to buy, sell, trade. They also had some money, but that was what they used to rely on the most, was their crops, their harvest, their agricultural system. So the Feast of First Fruits was a feast that, as they would harvest the fruits, they would basically, it was like giving a tithe of the fruits back, because God said that it is God controls the heavens and the earth. And as we read in the Old Testament, I believe it is in the book of Deuteronomy, God is telling Israel that it is by my authority, by my power, that the rains come and give you water so then your crops can grow. It is by my authority, by my power, that you are able to harvest, because God cares about us and God wants us to live. God does not want us to perish. So he is blessing us by allowing our harvest to be successful. So when God blesses us with harvest, it is only right that we give some of the harvest, or that they gave some of the harvest back to God as a thank you for allowing God, a thank offering for thanking God, allowing him and his grace and his mercy to allow them to harvest their food so then they could live. So this was a thank you celebration to God, again leading their minds to God. The fourth feast or holiday was Pentecost, and Pentecost was almost the same as the first fruits, but first fruits were for fruits. Pentecost was for wheat. And as they will collect the harvest of wheat, they will give back to God as a thank you offering for God providing them with the harvest of wheat. The fifth holiday was the blowing of the trumpet, and that was a time of 10 days. They used to blow the trumpet as a warning. Why? Because the Day of Atonement is coming, so everybody now has to come together, confess their faults one to another, repent of their sins to God, and make sure that they are pure and holy and sanctified, because the Day of Atonement is coming. So again, this was a holiday of 10 days of repentance to God and trying to make themselves sanctified and pure. Again, this is a holiday that led their minds to God. The sixth holiday was the Day of Atonement, and we understand on that day the high priest were to go into the sanctuary, into the most holy place, once a year, and that was called the Day of Atonement, that once a year, that one day. And what the high priest would do is make an atonement and a special sacrifice for the people, so then all the sins that the people did on that year, God will blot it out from his memory, and now you will start clean again and new, so then you can live and try to live a more godly life. And the goal is to have as less sins as possible each year, so then you can live a perfect life. That is why God gave this feast to Israel. And then if you commit sin, you go and you repent of your sins, and then when the Day of Atonement comes, God will utterly wipe that out from his memory. It was a time to become reconciliated with God, because sin is what separates us from God. And the only way to get back together is if we repent and confess our sins, and God will be faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. That's 1 John 1 verse 9. So this was a holiday again of bringing our minds, bringing their minds back towards God. The seventh and last holiday was the Feast of Tabernacles, and that was a time to reflect on God's goodness and mercy. So this was almost like Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving was a holiday that our pilgrims set up when they came here to the New World in 1620, and they set up Thanksgiving as a day of giving thanks to God for watching over them, for taking care of them, and guiding them through all this time. So this was what the Feast of Tabernacles was about. It was a time to reflect on God's goodness and God's mercy. Again, this is a holiday. This is a feast of leading one's mind back towards God. So all the holidays that God gave Israel was to guide their minds towards Him, to guide their minds towards God. The moment that Israel stopped celebrating these holidays, and usually the Bible mentions the first one they would stop celebrating was Passover, the first moment that they stopped celebrating the holidays that led their minds to God, the moment they stopped, that was the moment that Israel turned and did evil in the sight of the Lord and started doing apostasy, started worshiping these false idols, started to become sexually immoral, sexual harassment everywhere. These guys started to act worse than the pagan heathens. And that's what happened every single time when they lost their eyes off of God, when they stopped keeping the holidays that God told them to keep, which was the purpose to keep their minds towards Him. The moment they took their eyes off, that's the moment that they started apostatizing. And really, because every time when the holiday, this is a holiday to honor God. Okay, this holiday is to honor God. You always have your mind captivated to God, because you're always having holidays to deal with that lead you back towards God. So today, we have a different calendar than the one that God gave Israel. And again, we can do nothing about it. I am not saying to abolish the calendar that we live in today. Again, that is the established system. But we have holidays that people celebrate that are not God-given holidays, except for Thanksgiving. They're not God-given holidays. They are pagan, satanic ritual, sexual ritual holidays. Sexual rites holidays that the pagans used to honor. New Year's. What was New Year's? New Year's was to the Romans and Greeks and Egyptians, especially the Romans, New Year's was a day that they would honor Janus, their god, which is where we get January from. Janus was the god of the Romans, and what would the Romans do on New Year's? They would get drunk, they would have revelry, they would have celebrations, they would have sexual orgies, they would have sexual harassing women, they would have anything they want. Kind of like today. Today, everybody gets drunk on New Year's. According to the studies, New Year's is one of the top holidays that people purchase alcohol in. Alcohol shops thrive during New Year's. That's what they do. They get drunk, they have sexual encounters, they start doing all this type of stuff, and what you think follows? Sexual harassment follows. In fact, according to studies, 62% of people say they thought they would have a chance for a sexual encounter during New Year's. 62% of the studies of Americans showing that people have their minds towards sexual pleasure in New Year's more than any other day right now. 62%. That's what happens when you have a society that is keeping pagan holidays instead of the biblical ways that God has led us. This is what's going to happen. So we complain why society is how the way they are, why killings are happening, why women are being abused and sexually harassed, because we are keeping holidays that are not leading us to God, they are leading us to do all this bad stuff. Going further, the next holiday, Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day is a day where we are supposed to show love to one another. Really? What type of love? Godly love, brotherly love, or sexual love? Well, 32% of Americans say that they had a sexual encounter on Valentine's Day. That's the day they say they would have a sexual encounter, is on Valentine's Day. 32% of Americans. Doesn't seem like a big number. One out of three. But that number jumps to 68%, almost 70% amongst millennials. Millennials say that 68% of millennials say they had a sexual encounter on Valentine's Day, and that is the day to do it. It is no doubt why February 14th, Valentine's Day, is also a day called National Condom Day. Just to throw that out there. And really what they would do in Valentine's Day was a Roman, a pagan Roman celebration called Lupercalia. And what they used to do was, men used to go out in the street and used to whip women with rods or lashes, whatever they found, and used to whip women, and women used to accept these lashes, and they used to think that by getting lashes, they would become more fertile. This was a fertility rite celebration. This was a time everybody used to get drunk, have sexual orgies, and have sexual encounters. Again, sexual harassment thrived on this holiday. Women will go and write their names on cards, put them in a box. The men, the young men, will start picking the names out of the box, and whatever name of women they had, they were to be sexual partners for the rest of the year until the next celebration comes. I'm not going to go too deep on it because I made a video called Why Do We Celebrate Valentine's Day? If you want to look at the origin of Valentine's Day, you can go back and study that and look at that video. It's there, according to what the Bible and historians say about what went on during that holiday. But I want to look at that holiday a little differently this time. I want to go and look at, this is taken from the book, The 2B1, The 2B1 by Ernest Steed, The Revealed Secrets of Long-Hidden Mysticism and Religion. And talking about Cupid and the symbol of the heart and the arrow, it says, Cupid, or Eros, which was his name according to the Greeks, Cupid, the young winged boy with the bow and arrow, supposedly shoots his arrow of desire, creating love. The Greeks and Romans symbolized this god of love with the heart being pierced by an arrow. Again, Cupid was the Roman and Greek god of erotic love. Going on, it says, doesn't it seem strange that piercing the heart would bring love? The representation is somewhat devious because the heart and arrow are symbolic of the female and male sex organs. This is what Valentine's Day was all about, celebrated on February 14th by the pagans. Going down, it says, this act of union towards non-duality is visualized by the heart and arrow. The heart pierced the arrow is a symbol of conjunction, sexual conjunction. Eros is the Greek word for sexual love with definite sexual connotations. That is what Valentine's Day was about. Cupid was celebrated. That was the god of erotic love. Again, they used to do things, the pagans used to do things in Valentine's Day that is unbiblical. Again, going on with statistics, 30% of cheaters say they cheat on Valentine's Day. That's their day to cheat. One out of three. That may seem little, but that we got 320 plus million people living in this nation. And that's not saying the whole world. And you know how many cheaters that amounts to? Just think about that for a moment. Valentine's Day is not to honor God, it is to honor your sexual desire. Sexually harassment is thriving because the holidays we are keeping lead towards sexual harassment than towards God. Just like the Jews, they kept holidays that led them towards God, not towards this stuff. How about the next holiday? Easter. Easter. What does that have to do with the resurrection of Christ? Again, I'm not going to deal heavily on Easter because, again, I already made a video, if you want to look at it, it's called Why Do We Celebrate Easter? And there I break down what historians have to say in connection with the Bible, what it has to say with the Encyclopedia Britannica and all these major historians, tying them up together, looking at the history of Easter. And we understand that the Bible and historians all agree it has nothing to do with the resurrection of Christ. But let me read a bit from the historians. This is taken from Hazeltine, talking about Easter. It says the name Easter comes to us from Ostara or Oster, Ostre, the Anglo-Saxon goddess of spring, for whom a spring festival was held annually, as it is from this pagan festival that some of our Easter customs have come from. This is from Hazeltine, page 53. Again, Easter comes to us in the springtime when, you know, we feel this, the mating season, and yeah, the birds and the bees are flying around. Again, this Easter was the goddess of sexual, was the goddess of the spring, which brought forth sexual things. Want to know? Let's go down to Will Durant. Was a famous historian, and he wrote a book called Story of Civilization, and he says Easter or Easter or Astarte to the Greeks, Ashtoreth to the Jews, you read about that in the Bible, interest us not only as analog of the Egyptian Isis or the prototype of the Grecian Aphrodite and the Roman Venus, or meaning that this goddess is the same but had different names according to different civilizations. Egypt, Venus, Egypt, Isis, Roman, Venus, the Jews, was Ashtoreth, also Queen of Heaven, also in the Bible. It says this goddess of Easter is what they used to do during Easter in this spring festival. The pagans, this is what they used to do. Every native woman is obliged once in her life to sit in the temple of Venus or Easter, or Ishtar as it is pronounced, and have intercourse with some stranger. Again, that is what they used to do. That is what they used to do during the celebration of Easter. The problem is we have taken it and whitewashed it, reshaped it, remolded it a little bit, and named it now after Christ. But it has the same, we keep the same traditions. What about the rabbit? What about the eggs? What does that have to do? Well, let's look at Francis Weiser's book, Handbook on Christian Feast and Customs, page 233. It says the origin of the Easter egg is based on fertility lore of the Indo-European races. This is all about fertility. To the rabbit. Let's look at what the rabbit means. The Easter bunny. It says going down to Encyclopedia Britannica, 1991 edition, volume 4, page 333. It says the hare or the rabbit or the bunny is a symbol of fertility in the ancient Egypt, a symbol that was kept later in Europe. Its place has been taken by the Easter rabbit. Again, these are things that have nothing to do with Christ. They have everything to do with sexual encounters. They have everything. With that comes sexual harassment. No wonder we complain why people are doing these things, because we're keeping holidays that are anti-God and they are for what brings sexual harassment. Unconsciously, that is what is going on. We are keeping holidays that are not in favor of God. We ask why God ain't blessing the nation. It is because we're keeping holidays that in the Bible, God tells us not to keep, because the heathens used to keep it. And that is what was one of the reasons that they used to do against what God said. Going on, how about Christmas time? Well, you know that 60% of people say that they are more likely to have a sexual hookup during the holiday season. The week before Christmas was actually, studies show that it is the time that babies get conceived the most. I wonder why. You know, the Christmas tree, kissing under the mistletoe, and I've made videos on, I have a four-part video series on Christmas. Why do we celebrate Christmas? What's the meaning of Christmas trees? Where does Santa Claus come from? What is the mistletoe Yule log all about? But just to touch on it briefly, kissing under the mistletoe was a pagan ritual, a pagan rite that used to bring in fertility, and it was all about sexual fertility and being, and they used to have their way with women, women with men, and all the sexual perversion. This was what brought forth sexual harassment, especially during the Roman world. It was everywhere. And is the same today. Why? Because we have a, we are living under a Roman calendar, a pagan Roman calendar, and we are keeping the ancient pagan traditions, the ancient pagan holidays. It's just that they are renamed, some of them are renamed, they're rewashed, they are, they're recolored, reshaped and remolded, and but the traditions are still there. It is still there. So what's the solution? Should we go back to celebrating the feast days? No, that was nailed to the cross. I just brought that up to show you an example that God once gave his people a certain calendar to live by with certain holidays that were meant to get our minds captivated towards him. And today we have a pagan holiday, a pagan calendar with holidays to get our minds towards anti Bible ways. So how do we fix the problem? Do we go back? No. Do we get rid of it, of this pagan calendar? No. It's already set up, we live by it. But what we can do is stop celebrating these holidays and dwell on the Word of God and dwell on what the Bible says, because these holidays, I mean, really, why, when it comes to Valentine's Day, why am I going to celebrate Valentine's Day when I know that's a day that pagans used to honor their sexual gods with? I mean, I got 365 days a year to show love to my loved one. Why do I have to choose that day to show love when I know that day was a day where sexual harassment went on like wildfire in the Roman world? And guess what? It is no different today. Today we see people all everywhere. Sexual harassment reigns now. It's like one by one they are resigning their positions because they're being accused of sexual harassment. But really we're looking at society and be like, how did this come about? We're reaping the whirlwind because we are keeping holidays that lead more towards that sexual perversion lifestyle than it is towards God. And when you look at the calendar that God gave Israel, it was a calendar with holidays that led them towards him and not towards the pagan ways. So again, I would say we, not to get rid of the calendar, again, is a system, we are, it's already established, but we got to stop, let go of these traditions of men, as Christ says, and keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus, as the Bible says. So that is one of the reasons why I wanted to bring this out. Again, not everybody may agree, and that's okay, but I wanted to show out from the Bible, from a little bit of history, from statistics, that sexual harassment and the holidays go hand in hand. It goes all the way back centuries, millenniums ago, and it went hand in hand back in those days and is going hand in hand again today. Men get roused up when they see a woman, and really, you want people to stop comment and treating you like that? Well, maybe stop wearing that bikini. You know, maybe stop wearing those tight dresses, those tight pants, you know, all those things. You know, there's a modest way on how to dress. And really, people want, women want to dress scantily and show everything off of their body, like if they're for sale, like if they're a prostitute. So if you want to dress and show yourself off, expect these comments and things to happen. I'm not justifying it, but I'm saying it's going to come. Meanwhile, if you dress a more godly manner, if you dress more loosely instead of tightly, you know, these tight fitted dresses that show everything off, you know, maybe men would guide themselves back towards God because you are dressing a godly way. And again, that's not going to stop all sexual harassments. I mean, I'm not saying I don't want to offend anybody. If you want to wear a bikini and stuff, that's your situation. But I'm saying, if you're going to do that and show your body off, that's how men also get aroused and so perverted. the same thing for men likewise. It goes both ways. So that is what the Bible, I believe the Bible has to say when it comes to sexual harassment and the holidays. They both go together. Again, you may not agree. I'm just bringing this out. And that is what I felt necessary to bring out going by what's happening in society today. So thank you for watching this video. If you like this video, please press like. Also, don't forget to subscribe. We're also on Facebook at Expounding the Bible. Until then, this is your host, Nathanael Morel, saying, have a blessed day.